wear masks, or you don't need to wear one if you're vaccinated. So we're working on more things, and we'll let you know how the social distancing is supposed to end May 31st, and then we'll see about singing at the next consistory. So that's the update that we have so far. Today we're going to learn about the birthday church. We're going to learn what's so amazing, so incredible, the church that we're part of. We're also going to honor our graduates a little later in the service. So please join in the call to worship in the bulletin. As a deer longs for a stream of cool water,
so I long for you, O God.
I thirst for you, the living God.
When can I go and worship in your presence?
I will put my hope in God, and I will again praise him.
May the Lord show his constant love each day.
Thank you.
reminding us that we are made new. Through Jesus Christ, our sins are forgiven. Amen. Please be seated. Well, we want to invite our graduates to come forward, and Susan Chadle, so Tori, Dakota, and Zach, and Faith could be here today. Such a mom died, you're too busy.
From Allison.
Tori, tell us a little bit about what your plans are.
I plan to live in Penn State in September 2 years to become a physical therapist.
And you're taking the summer off?
No, I'm working.
Are you all your life for?
No. Thank you for that birthday of the church, and we thank you for the ways that you help us.
when we think we can't do something, and help us to always ask you to be our help. Amen. All right, thanks for listening, Olivia. Our first reading is from Acts 2, verses 1 through 21. When the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. Suddenly, a sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. They saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. Now there were staying in Jerusalem God-fearing Jews from every nation under heaven. When they heard this sound, a crowd came together in bewilderment, because each one heard their own language being spoken. Utterly amazed, they asked, "Aren't all these who are speaking Galileans? Then how is it that each of us hears them in our native language? Parthians, Medes, and Elamites, residents of Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt and the parts of Libya near Cyrene, visitors from Rome, both Jews and converts to Judaism, Cretans and Arabs, we hear them declaring the wonders of God in our own tongues." Amazed and perplexed, they asked one another, "What does this mean?" Some, however, made fun of them and said, "They have had too much wine." Then Peter stood up with the 11, raised his voice, and addressed the crowd, "Fellow Jews and all of you who live in Jerusalem, let me explain this to you. Listen carefully to what I say. These people are not drunk, as you suppose. It's only 9 in the morning. No, this is what was spoken by the prophet Joel. In the last days, God says, I will pour out my spirit on all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your young men will see visions. Your old men will dream dreams. Even on my servants, both men and women, I will pour out my spirit in those days, and they will prophesy. I will show wonders in the heavens above and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and billows of smoke. The sun will be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the great and glorious day of the Lord. And everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved." A reading from 2 Timothy 1, verses 3 to 14. "I thank God, whom I serve as my ancestors did, with a clear conscience, as night and day I constantly remember you in my prayers. Recalling your tears, I long to see you, so that I may be filled with joy. I am reminded of your sincere faith, which first lived in your grandmother Lois and in your mother Eunice, and I am persuaded now lives in you also. For this reason, I remind you to fan into flame the gift of God, which is in you through the laying on of my hands. For the Spirit God gave us did not make us timid, but gives us power, love, and self-discipline. So do not be ashamed of the testimony about our Lord, of me, or of me his prisoner. Rather join with me in suffering for the gospel by the power of God. He has saved us and called us to a holy life, not because of anything we have done, but because of his own purpose and grace. This grace was given us in Christ Jesus before the beginning of time, but it has now been revealed through the appearing of our Savior, Christ Jesus, who has destroyed death and has brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. And of this gospel I was appointed a herald and an apostle and a teacher. That is why I am suffering as I am. Yet this is no cause for shame, because I know whom I have believed and am convinced that he is able to guard what I have entrusted to him until that day. What you heard from me, keep as the pattern of sound teaching, with faith and love in Christ Jesus. Guard the good deposit that was entrusted to you. Guard it with the help of the Holy Spirit who lives in us. The gospel reading is in the bulletin if you'd like to follow along. It's John 15, verses 26 through 27, and John 16, verses 4 through 15. I have told you this so that when their time comes, you will remember that I warned you about them. I did not tell you this from the beginning because I was with you, but now I am going to him who sent me. None of you asks me, where are you going? Rather, you are filled with grief because I have said these things. But very truly I tell you, it is for your good that I am going away. Unless I go away, the Advocate will not come to you. But if I go, I will send him to you. When he comes, he will prove the world to be in the wrong about sin and righteousness and judgment. About sin, because people do not believe in me. About righteousness, because I am going to the Father, where you can see me no longer. And about judgment, because the prince of the world now stands condemned. I have much more to say to you, more than you can now bear. But when he, the Spirit of truth, comes, he will guide you into all the truth. He will not speak on his own. He will speak only what he hears, and he will tell you what is yet to come. He will glorify me, because it is from me that he will receive what he will make known to you. All that belongs to the Father is mine. That is why I said, the Spirit will receive from me what he will make known to you. This is the good news.
Praise to you, O Christ.
And our listening hymn is the insert in the bulletin, In Christ There Is No East or West. Because what happened on day one tells us a lot. church asked for a gift, what would it want? And why it's a whole lot different than the kind of gift you might think. You know, before Jesus left his followers and went up to heaven, he told them they should wait in Jerusalem, wait for the gift that his Father promised. And he said, you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit and you will receive power. He didn't say how it would happen or what would happen or when it would happen. But they were going to get the Holy Spirit. And the disciples must have wondered what sort of power would come from the Holy Spirit. You know, could they read minds or, you know, speak well and win arguments? Would they have superhuman strength? But Jesus just told them they would be witnesses in Jerusalem, in Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. And the disciples asked Jesus, well, could you restore the kingdom to Israel now? They were hoping for a different gift from the Holy Spirit. They were hoping Jesus would help them as Israel defeat the Roman Empire so they could be their own country once again. They were hoping for a gift that was what they wanted. You know, they were thinking about themselves. And Jesus didn't give them a real good answer to their question. He said, it's not for them to know, but he promises, at least, you're going to receive the Holy Spirit and be my witnesses. So Jesus went up to heaven, and the disciples waited, just like Jesus said. They waited, they prayed, and they were gathered, not just the 12 disciples, but there were other followers, including women and Jesus' mother and brothers. And then the day finally came. As they were together in one room, the sound like a violent wind filled the house. And then they saw tongues of flame resting on each person. And all of them were filled with the Holy Spirit. And by the power of the Spirit, they spoke languages they didn't even know. And outside, the people were drawn by the sound of what was going on in this room. And Jews were there from many nations. They came to Jerusalem to celebrate the Pentecost holiday. And they formed a crowd and they gathered to listen. The followers of Jesus were speaking their language. You know, the Jews from the other nations said, hey, we hear them declaring the wonders of God in our own languages. They were amazed. And they said, what does this mean? And some people sneered and said, oh, they had too much wine. So Peter stood up and he spoke to the crowd. He said, they're not drunk. This is what the prophet Joel had said. In the last days, God will pour out his Spirit on all people, and your sons and daughters will prophesy, and your young men will see visions, and your old men will dream dreams. Even on my male and female servants and slaves, I will pour out my Spirit. And everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. So Peter is telling them that God has given this gift of the Holy Spirit, but it's a different kind of gift. And it's not the usual kind of gift. You know, someone gives you a gift, it's usually for you to enjoy. You know, clothes for you to wear, money for you to spend, toys for you to enjoy, a gift card to a restaurant that you like. But Jesus' followers, back before he ascended, they expected the gift of the Holy Spirit to be something just for them. And they expected a gift that they wanted, this political win for Israel, this triumph for them to enjoy. They wanted greatness. They wanted Jesus to sit on the throne and they'd be on the left and the right side. But the gift came and it was different. And it wasn't for their enjoyment and their glory. The gift came and it was for them to use for someone else. So on Pentecost, the gift of the Holy Spirit was given to them, but not for their enjoyment. It was so the Jews of the foreign nations could hear about God and enjoy a message in the language that they spoke. It was a gift that offered hospitality, showing that God cares about the foreigner and the outsider. So the good news of Pentecost is that God sends the Holy Spirit to give us gifts of power. And it might be wisdom, it might be faith, and maybe you get the gift of being a good listener. Maybe you get the gift of helping others when they need it. But whatever gift you get, God wants you to use it for someone else. So it's a gift you receive, but you can think of it as a gift you get for someone else. Because, there was no selfishness when it came to following Jesus. The church was founded as a gift given to Jesus' followers for the people outside of the church, because the church exists for the world. And, today we honor our graduates, and all our graduates have gifts, and it's clear in all they've done and their plans for the future. The Spirit has blessed you, and in all the ways that you serve, you show that you know that your gifts are for someone else, that you're here to help and serve others. And, in this year, when things weren't the way that we hoped, more than ever, the world needs your help. The world needs us to be for them and use our gifts to help them. And so, Tori, we talked about last week about the Sunday school and how you help the Sunday school for high school, and you kind of, like, you're so good at sports, and somehow, we always think, well, if you do sports, you can't do church, but you were here for Sunday school, and the kids had so much fun with you, and I think a little Owen and you teasing each other, and so, we're really blessed that you used your gifts for others. And Zach, we see that you've been helping with charity softball tournaments, and so you've used your gift for others. And I know Faith, I saw a Facebook post of her at Mission Central. They had a day-long mission event where they went and they helped. That's the Methodist warehouse that they helped with items for disasters, packing things up. And Dakota, we're all just so thankful for that wonderful project you did as an Eagle Scout when you helped put the tombstones in the cemetery. And, that was just really impressive. So we want to celebrate all of your service and all the ways that you've used your gifts to help other people. And so today, the church's birthday, the gift that the church wants is that all of us serve somebody else. You've received the Holy Spirit. Gifts have been poured on you. You have some skills, and you have a heart for a certain group of people, and there's a need for you to serve. So we have gifts to use to serve someone else. And that doesn't mean we don't get anything out of serving. You receive so many blessings when you help. You get to know people. You get to experience that we're all connected. We're here for each other. When my son Ian was in elementary, he was in Cub Scouts. And one day we were walking down the street and we saw his Cub Master start chatting. And during the conversation, it came up. Ian thought this Cub Scout Master was paid for what he did as a Cub Scout leader. And we smiled and like, no, it's not a paid job. And Ian, he was just amazed. Couldn't believe that somebody put in all this work and they didn't get paid for it. And I think the church is kind of like that. It's amazing what we do for the world. And so you are all amazing what you do for the world. So I want you to tell somebody around you, tell them you are amazing. You're amazing. So church starts. when the gift of the Holy Spirit came down in a really powerful way. And it didn't come for the glory of the disciples. It came so that they could speak God's word in the languages of all the people gathered, so that all could understand. The church began by serving others. And so the perfect gift to give the Christian church is willing hearts and hands. So let us be the church, not for ourselves, but for the world. Amen. And today is the Strengthen the Church offering, and there's envelopes, and it's an offering for the UCC. It helps us do our 5 for 5. It helps start new churches, renew existing churches, and develop leaders. So thank you for your generosity. Please stand, and we'll affirm our faith with the testimony of the Apostles' Creed. I believe
in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only begotten Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits on the right hand.
All glory, honor, and praise to you, O God. All this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Let us pray the prayer our Savior taught us. Our
Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Gracious God, you have enriched us in every way. We thank you that we can share and pass along blessings to others. Bless these gifts that they may demonstrate your love and build your kingdom. Amen.
So we're grateful today for the church, and we ask you to consider helping with Vacation Bible School. This year it'll be at Trinity, but if you can help in any way, you can sign up and let us know. That's a great way to share the love of the church with the world. So go out into the world filled with the spark of the Holy Spirit. Let love guide your actions. Listen for the Spirit of truth. Spread the peace of Christ and remind everyone you meet that each one of us is a beloved child of God. Amen.